A warm welcome to dear students for today's topic, Merkantia, Structure and Reproduction. Let us first talk about the systematic position of Merkantia. Merkantia belongs to division Bryophyta, class Hepaticopsida, order Merkantiales, family Merkantiaceae, and genus Merkantia. Merkantia has been named in the honor of Nicholas Merchant, the then director of the botanical garden of Gaston de Orleans in Blois, France. The genus is distributed all over the world. It includes about 65 species, 11 of which are reported from India. The species occur in dense green patches in the moist, cold and shady terrestrial habitats. In India, it occurs mostly in the hills, on forest floor, shaded cliffs, tree trunks, or the muddy bank of water courses. Merkantia polymorpha is the most common species reported from Himalayan mountains, South Indian hills, and plains. It grows abundantly to 4,572 meters. Merkantia palmata grows at an altitude of 2,438 meters in Himalayas and South Indian hills. However, it is commonly found in Kashmir and Punjab. The other common species of India are Merkantia nepalensis, Merkantia indica, and Merkantia similana. Plants bearing sex organs are found in the months of February and March in the Himalayas and October and November in South Indian hills. Now, gametophytic plant body. The plant body of Merkantia is a haploid gametophyte, usually called as thallus, because it lacks true roots, stem, and leaves. External structure. The gametophytic plant body is green, prostrate, dorsiventral, and dichotomously branched. Each branch has an apical notch with a growing point at its base. The mature thallus is 2 to 10 centimeters in length and 0.5 to 3 centimeters in breadth. Now, dorsal surface of the thallus. The dorsal surface of the thallus is dark green with a broad dark and median thickening called midrib, which is marked as a shallow groove. It is marked into polygonal or rhomboidal areas called areoles or areoli. These indicate the outline of underlying air chambers. In the center of each areole lies an air pore which connects the air chamber with the external environment. There are small cup-like structures present along the midrib. They are called Gemma cups. The Gemma cups bear gemmae which help in vegetative multiplication. In the adult gametophyte, the dorsal surface bears certain upright branches near the apical notches known as gametophores, which bear sex organs. Now, ventral surface of the thallus. The ventral surface of the thallus along the midrib is marked by a median longitudinal groove. On both sides of this groove arise numerous rhizoids and scales. The rhizoids are colorless or pale brown, unicellular, unbranched, tubular outgrowths. They are of two types, smooth-walled and tuberculate. The smooth-walled rhizoids are comparatively broader with smooth thin walls. They help in fixation and absorption of water and minerals from the soil. The tuberculate rhizoids originate beneath the scales and converge towards the midrib. They are narrow and have comparatively thick walls. From the inner walls of these rhizoids develop many peg-like outgrowths or tubercles, which project towards their lumen. Tubercle rhizoids run horizontally along the underside of the thallus to form a capillary conducting system, thereby helping conduction of water to all the absorptive areas of the thallus. The scales are arranged in 2 to 4 rows on each side of the midrib. In Mochansia polymorpha, there are 3 rows of scales, which are respectively known as median, laminar, and marginal rows. The median scales are also called appendiculate. They are large and wedge-shaped in outline. The median scale has 3 parts: body, neck, and appendage. The outer scales, that is marginal and laminar ones, are simple or ligulate, tongue-shaped without any appendage. Each scale is multicellular, membranous, plate-like, and one cell thick. They are purplish in color because of the presence of anthocyanin. Oil cells are also present in the scales. The marginal scales possess mucilage papillae. Mucilage protects the cells from desiccation. The scales retain moisture and transport water by capillarity. Now, internal structure of the thallus. When viewed in a vertical section, the thallus shows a high degree of internal differentiation of internal tissues, many layers thick in the middle and a few layers towards the margins. The cells are arranged in 3 different regions. These are epidermal region, photosynthetic region, and storage region. Now, epidermal region. The thallus has a well-defined upper and lower epidermis. The upper epidermis covers the thallus over the dorsal surface. It is single-layered, sometimes two-layered, for example, in Mochansia indica. It consists of thin-walled cells, which contain a few discoid chloroplasts. The outer walls of these cells are cutanized, hence slightly thickened. The epidermis is interrupted by many barrel-shaped air pores, one on the roof of each air chamber. Each air pore is surrounded by 16 to 40 cells, having cutanized walls and a few chloroplasts. These cells are arranged in 4 to 8 superimposed ringed tiers, one above the another. Each tier consists of 4 to 5 cells. They are arranged in the form of small chimney, which encloses a wide passage, which is broad in middle and narrow above and below. The pore wall lies half below the epidermis and therefore opening the pore in slightly raised above the surface of the thallus. Now, photosynthetic region, just beneath the upper epidermis, there is single horizontal row of air chambers separated from each other by a single-layered partition wall with 2 to 4 cells in height. Each chamber opens out through a chimney-like or barrel-shaped air pore. The air chambers are hexagonal in surface view and look rectangular in vertical section. A large number of short, simple, and branched filaments of green cells arise from the floor of each chamber. These are called photosynthetic or assimilatory filaments. The cells of the assimilatory filaments, partition walls, and floor of the air chamber contain numerous disc-shaped chloroplasts. The chambered region is therefore the principal center of photosynthesis in the thallus. Now, storage region. This zone lies on the ventral side of the thallus. It is the thickest in the center and gradually becomes thin towards the margins. The tissue consists of compactly arranged parenchymates and isodiametric cells rich in starch and proteins. Intercellular spaces are absent. A few cells are filled with mucilage or oil bodies. Some cells of the storage region possess reticulate and pitted thickenings. They are called sclerates. In some species, central part of the midrib region contains elongated mucilage tubes which prevent the cells from desiccation. The storage region on the ventral side is covered by lower epidermis, which is made of non-green caudate cells. From the lower epidermis arise rhizoids and scales. Now, reproduction. Dear students, Mockenzie reproduce by vegetative and sexual means. Vegetative reproduction. The vegetative reproduction takes place by many ways, such as fragmentation, regeneration, formation of adventitious branches, and formation of gamete. Now, fragmentation, this is the most common method of reproduction in Mockenzie. As a result of aging of mature cells of posterior region of the thallus, they die and disintegrate. When the decaying of the cells reaches the dichotomy, each lobe of the thallus gets separated. Each lobe, by the apical growth, develops into an independent plant and results in a rapid increase of the thalli. Regeneration. Any separated or severed plant part can regenerate into the whole plant if conditions are favorable. Formation of adventitious branches. Under favorable conditions, the thallus gives rise to adventitious branches. These branches usually develop from the ventral surface of the thallus, though they may also develop from any part of the thallus. These branches, on separation due to decay of the connecting tissue, develop into new thalli. Now, asexual reproduction by gamete. An interesting and special method of vegetative reproduction occurs by special reproductive bodies known as gamete. In Mockenzie, gyma are produced in autumn and spring inside small gyma cups on the dorsal surface in the midrib region. These gyma cups in the beginning appear as circular areas a short distance behind the apical cell, but on account of the upward growth of the adjoining vegetative tissue, they soon become hollow cavities. Now, development of gyma. A small area appears in the form of the depression near the growing point on the dorsal surface of the thallus, which differentiates into a gyma cup. The gamete originate from the epidermal cells lining the floor of the cupule. One of the epidermal cell gives rise a papilla-like outgrowth and functions as a gyma initial. It divides by transverse divisions to form a basal cell, a stalk cell, and a primary body cell. The stalk cell does not divide further and functions as a single cell stalk of the mature gyma. The primary cell of the gyma divides by a series of transverse divisions to form a filament of 4 to 5 cells. This is followed by a series of vertical and horizontal divisions to form the body of the mature gyma. At first, the gyma is only one cell in thickness, but due to periclinal divisions of central cells, it becomes several cells thick in the center, and as a result, the gyma becomes disc-shaped. Now, structure of a mature gyma. Each gyma consists of a multicellular green body and a unicellular hyaline stalk, with which it is attached to the base of the gyma cup. The body of the gyma is elliptical and flattened like a double convex lens. The gyma is 4 to 5 cells thick towards the middle and gradually thins out to become single-layered towards the margin. The margin bears 2 shallow lateral and opposite notches growing points are situated in these notches, the jami of some species can have 3 or 4 growing points. Most of the cells of jami are chloronchymates. However, a few individual cells just below the margin may possess oil bodies instead of chloroplasts. They are called oil cells. On the dorsal surface of the jima are scattered some larger colorless cells with denser granular cytoplasm. These are called rhizoidal cells because they can produce rhizoids after falling on the moist substratum. The jima may also possess few mucilage cells for retaining moisture. At the base of the jima, there is another notch where the hyaline stalk is attached. The cells bordering this notch have very weak cells. The mature jima breaks its connection from the stalk cell in many ways. Number one, due to raindrop splash, due to the pressure of the young growing jami, due to the swelling of the mucilage hairs, and number four, due to the water tension created in the jima cup by the secretion of mucilage hairs. Now, germination of the jima. The young jami get released after breaking off the single-celled stalks. Raindrops may carry the jami up to a distance of 1 meter and are further carried away by water currents and animals. The jami germinate as soon as they get a suitable substratum. One or both of the growing points become active. The surface of the jima, which comes in contact with the substratum, becomes the ventral surface, and that which remains exposed becomes the dorsal surface. The upper surface develops air chambers, and from the lower surface develop rhizoids, which penetrate into the soil and start water absorption. Both the growing points become active, and 2 thalli are produced in opposite directions by death and decay of the middle portion of the jima. The jima produced on the male thallus gives rise to male thalli, while as those produced from the female ones, they develop into the female thalli. With this, we conclude the structure of Mauconchia and vegetative reproduction of Mauconchia. We will continue it in the next lecture, where we will discuss about sexual reproduction of Mauconchia. Thank you. Thank you.